Aristotle's right. You know, all objects want to be in their natural state, and basically that means, you know, every object wants to be on the ground and, you know, not moving. He said that in order for, you know, an object to move, you know, it requires a natural force. So let's see. Yo. Hey. Hey, wake up. Hey, you gotta move. You gotta do this, man. You gotta do this. You gotta run. Keep walking.
There you go.
He's right. He's right again.
Aristotle was not completely right on the fact that you only need a force to move. He was right on the fact that you need a force, but that's actually a force to accelerate. I mean, take this for example. Me and this water bottle are moving at a constant speed, and it's relative to each other. The water bottle is not moving to me, but relative to you, it is moving. But when I throw the water bottle with this, a force, it accelerates. It moved faster compared to me. Then you need a force to accelerate. Galileo was indeed correct. Light follows three simple rules. The first rule is that light travels in straight lines, much like this pole. It does not bend. The second rule is that light travels from an object to our eyes. So it reflects off of objects such as these grapes to our eyes.
You put it in your mouth, right?
So, the third light rule. Well, what is it, dude? What is it?
It's like something about light going like super fast.
Whoa.
Pretty super dank Oculus fast.
Whoa! That's crazy. Whoa. I mean, like, how fast exactly does it travel? Like, what number? Like, give me some numbers, man.
It's 186,000 miles per second.
So that means if, you know, so the light that's coming from the sun travels to Earth instantaneously. Is that correct?
The sun is 93 million miles away. That's hella. So you do 93 million divided by 186,000.
Mm-hmm.
And you figure out that it takes 8.3 minutes to get here. So we're actually observing 8.3 minute old light.
Whoa.
Because light travels at a certain speed, so even it has a limit to how fast it can travel.
Oh, okay.
Which is pretty super dectonculus fast.
Wow, that's crazy.
Hello. We're just showing off a lever right now. Essentially, what's happening is that I'm putting more weight on this foot, which allows me to raise him. But when I lift off the weight from this foot, it goes back up. See? That's exactly what a lever is. It allows for more work to be done with less force input. So the longer this stick would be, the less it would have to go down to raise this side up. So that's pretty much exactly what a lever is.
Hey, I forgot my physics journal. Christian, can you throw it up for me?
Yeah, sure.
Whoa, don't throw it, man. Just use the pulley. It's over there. Exactly. Well, basically, a pulley changes the direction of force. It also changes the magnitude of force if you have like more than one pulley. See?
Oh, sweet. That was so much easier.
I know, right? Yeah, exactly.
Hey, man. What's it got there?
Oh, this is our wheel and axle for physics class.
Really? That looks like a funnel to me.
Yeah. Well, you can make it out of anything. I mean,
really?
You've got your wheel and you've got your axle. So as I input a force here turning the wheel, the axle turns, pulling up the object, which in this case is the tape.
Really?
That's pretty much how the wheel and axle is going to work.
Wow. Yeah, that looks hella tight, man.
Yep.
Sebastian, I need help. It's too heavy.
Whoa, wait! You can't do that, man. It's not going to work, man. Not unless you use the incline plane over there.
Oh, I didn't see that.
Let's go. You know why? That's because you're still using the same amount of work, but it's only straight over a long period of time. Whoa, Aaron!
This does.
What are you doing, man?
I'm trying to get this done so we can get on with our physics video.
Are you? Well, dude, it ain't gonna work with a hammer because it's flat. It's not a wedge. All right, you need a wedge like an axe. Here, try this. Whoa, man, see? Did you see that? You know why? All right, based on my physics journal,
written by the notorious G. It says that, you know, when you apply the force using a wedge, the wedge actually splits the force even. So, I mean, it does make sense. That's why it splits the wood in half. I wake you, Randus, lose. Whoa! Man, what are you doing?
Trying to screw this in there.
Well, man, it ain't gonna work with a hammer. You gotta use this.
Sweet. So how does it work?
Well, basically, a screw has threads, right? And the spinning motion that you're doing right now, it causes an upper force, which makes the screw go into the wood, right?
That is.
That's why, you know, according to the physics journal by the notorious G, because, you know, the force is going into the wood, right? So that's our wedge, bro.
That is.